Ready?
Yes.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our third webinar in our season to study Jesus, the man behind the Gospels. My name is Wanu, and I'll be one of your presenters this evening. I'm not doing anything clever. I'm just telling you things like house rules and how webinars work, basically. So without further ado, today we're talking about Jesus, the man behind the Gospels, and in particular we're focusing on the works of Jesus. So just a few house rules. Everyone is on mute, and if you do have anything you want to say, if you want to ask a question at the end, there will be an opportunity at the end for people to ask questions. If you indicate by raising your hand, I will be able to see it on my screen. And then if you unmute yourself, you will be able to ask a question. Alternatively, you can type your question out where it says questions on the far right-hand side of your screen. Type your question and I'll be able to see it and I'll read it out for Dikin Bumi Olubode, who will be our expert speaker this evening. Toilets will be in your homes. In your homes. Please do not panic. The toilets will be in your homes. As I said, there will be an opportunity at the end to ask questions. So please raise your hands or type in the question for the opportunity. And I think that's it. We're recording the webinar. So if for any reason you have to leave or you're not able to listen to the end, please send an email to communications@jesushouse.org.uk and we'll be able to link you with the recorded message. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Dikin Bumi Olubode now, and he will delve into the works of Jesus. Dikin Bumi, over to you, sir.
Good evening, everybody. And welcome again to part three of the webinar series, which we started 2 weeks ago with the session that looked at why Jesus. We are in the webinar series, Jesus, the Man Behind the Gospels, and today we will be looking at the works of Jesus. But before we start, if you would just like to join me in a word of prayer. I hope everybody can hear me. If you can, please just type some comment in the chat window so I'm aware that you can hear me before we continue. Right, I'm just going to just pray for now. So if you would like to join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we bless your holy name. We are so grateful for an opportunity like this to gather together different locations, different places, using technology. Father, we are so grateful to you to share your word, to look into the scriptures, and to basically challenge ourselves by what you have already prepared and written for us. But Father, we can do this, we cannot do this by ourselves. We need your Holy Spirit to help us. But Father, so we just commit ourselves into your hands. Father, let your Holy Spirit open our hearts to your word and your word to our hearts, Heavenly Father. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would help me to speak only that which it is you will have me speak. I also do ask you, Holy Spirit, that everybody who is listening, Lord, you speak to them in the way that they will understand you and receive your word. And Father, let that word become life in each and every one of us. Thank you so much, Heavenly Father. All the glory belongs to you, and we give you praise, and we give you all the honor. In the name of Jesus Christ, we have prayed. So, oh, beautiful. Amen. 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 Okay, now let's get right into it. As usual, I like to put up an agenda first, just to give an indication of what we will be covering. Now, I'm sure you are all aware that a topic like this, Jesus, the man behind the Gospels, is quite a wide topic and to cover all that we would like to cover within the time that we have can be quite difficult. So we are probably going to only pick on a few things as we go through, but we certainly want to cover the work of salvation, because that was one of the main things that Jesus did for us, and it's our salvation. And we cannot talk about his works without talking about that. We started that off in webinar one, and we'll just continue again today. We'll look at model living God's way. So basically, Jesus came to model how we should live the way God would have us to live. And as you read through the Gospels, that's something that I think will be useful to be aware of, how he lived his life. It's a good example for us. We also look very briefly at one of the things that Jesus did while he was around, and this is destroying the works of the devil. And so we've said we'll have a little bit just looking at one or two things and pointing out a few things. And of course, the other bit of work that he did and will be doing, which was he began the process for re-establishing, I would say, the kingdom of God in the earth. And we'll touch on that, because that's it's part of what he is. And you can see that there's still quite a lot that Jesus did that we're not actually going to even cover from this one. But let's have a look and see what we have. Obviously, there will be certain things in there, some new things that you probably haven't heard before, some things that will surprise you probably. But with all things, just make sure that we do what it is we should do, which is our due diligence. We'll come to that again in a moment. Right, the prelude. Now, I always do this because I want to always point out to you that, look, I'm not an expert. I don't know everything, but I can share with you, and we can share with you what it is that we know. But all of it is all about helping, giving some background information to help us gain a little bit more while we study the Gospels. You know, I might say something that might cause you to pay a little bit more attention to some aspects, and that might help you a little bit. So everything that I'm saying here, please don't take it as gospel. It's some of them, yes, you will see and you will agree with. Some of them you think, I'm not quite sure about. Do challenge it. Be like the Berean Christians. Go and do your research. Don't just say, oh, Bumiolubode said this. Yeah, okay, might help you a little bit, but it's always better for you to do the research yourself. Okay, so let's get right into it. The work of salvation. Right. In the first webinar, we established that there is no atonement for sin without the shedding of blood. It's very clear throughout the Old Testament, and of course the scripture says that the soul that sins must die, and the only way that that can be prevented is through the shedding of blood. Okay, but thanks be to God for Jesus Christ. He fulfilled this for us when he entered the heavenly temple with his own blood, and you can find that in Hebrews 9:12. Yeah. And we did cover this again in the first webinar, so it's just a way of just bringing the whole thing together so you're aware of this. But how did he do this? How did he accomplish this? Now, we all know, at least for most Christians, probably even those who are non-Christians do, will know that he accomplished this on the cross. And so we will sort of take a brief look at some aspects of the cross. It's not going to be everything, because we can't sort of cover everything, but we'll have a look at some aspects of the cross. And one of the key things I want you to be aware of when you read through the Gospels in this period of time is that the account on the cross is revealed through all the Gospels. All four Gospels have them. And with that, when you go through the Gospels, you can see through the Gospels the different accounts as they link together in there. So when you go through the Gospels, look at it. Some aspects of the Gospels are explained in in Matthew with a little bit more detail, whereas Luke may cover another aspect of it. So, and it's very useful to read it in one sitting. I did that, I think it was on Saturday. I sat through and just read all the four accounts in the Gospel. And there were a few things that I picked up in there, which for me was, wow, okay, I never really noticed it because I hadn't done that together. So I thought that might just be helpful and useful to you to know. Okay, now, there's something very important that I wanted us to sort of have a look at, and this is this thing called tetelestai. That's the Greek word that the Lord pronounced on the cross before he gave up his spirit, when he said, "It is finished." Now, this is a very interesting word, and I did some research on it because I wanted to understand how the Greeks used that word and what it actually related to. Now, that word is also in Greek, can be used to mean paid in full, and you will see in a minute what I mean. Okay, that word is used in several different things. So, for example, a servant who has been given some work to do by his master, when he's finished or completed that task, he will say to the master, "Tetelestai," meaning I have completed that which it is you sent me to do. Yeah. Now, you also did have other, it was quite used by quite a number of people, and merchants also did that as well. So, for example, now, if a merchant were to issue a promissory note, meaning he's given a note of promise, I'm going to do this for you, I'm going to give you this if you do this, okay? When that promissory note is paid up, when the person pays that promissory note, it is written on that promissory note, I have to try and get that thing right, promissory note, tetelestai, which means paid in full. So you can see the use of those two. One of the most interesting ones that appealed to me or caught my attention was the way it is applied to prisoners. So when a Roman citizen is convicted of a crime and they're thrown in prison, they will write a certificate of debt and nail it to the prison door. So it's there on the prison, on the cell doors there. Okay. So this man has a debt to pay to society. Now, when that is finished, when the prisoner has completed his term and has been released, the jailers will write on it, or the judge actually will go back to court, and the judge will write on it, "Tetelestai," meaning paid in full. Then that will be handed over to the prisoner, so that whenever anybody challenges the prisoner, "What are you doing out of jail?" he can produce that and say, "Tetelestai." Now, if we look at what Jesus Christ has done for us when he looked at it, you can look at it from both sides and say, "It is finished," meaning, "Lord, I care, Father, the work that you sent me to do, I have completed the work, it is done." And you can look at it again, because actually it means both things from our perspective, because yes, he did complete the work that he was sent to do, but he also paid the price in full for our sins. So everything that we may, every sin, whether it's past, present, or future, is already paid for in full by Jesus Christ. We paid no part in that. He's done it all for us. The only thing that we are asked to do with that is whenever we sin, and sin really is about missing the mark, whenever we miss the mark, whenever we don't get it right, whenever we don't do what we're supposed to do, quickly, it's a repentance, a turning away, not just saying, "No, I'm really sorry," but going, not really meaning it. It's a real turning away. I turn away from what I have done, and you change your mind. That is the repentance. And once that is done, bam, the blood of Jesus covers that straight away, and you're free from the condemnation, or we are free from the condemnation that the sin may bring. So that's a very key thing that he did on the cross for us. But there's more to that. Now, in Matthew 27, 46, Matthew 27, 46, the scripture says, "And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,' That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Yeah? Now, this is a very interesting phrase. Two things there. This is probably the only time Jesus referred to God or to the Father, addressing him not by my Father or Father. He said, my God, my God. That was the time when he was separated by sin, when God probably, I mean, I always imagine God just turning away, turning his back on him on the cross, because now he was now covered with our sins. And Jesus felt that separation, and he couldn't call him Father anymore at that point in time, and just went and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Whenever I think about that, it actually makes me well up a little bit, because it's basically for my sake, he's done that. He gave that all up, and that separation, because most of the times all throughout the gospel, he will refer to him as my Father. He didn't refer to him as my God, but in this occasion, it's my God, why have you forsaken me? But if we look further, Psalm 22 verse 1, it has something very interesting. Psalm 22 verse 1 opens up again with a very similar phrase, my God, why have you forsaken me? Yeah, and you might think, oh, was Jesus Christ quoting Psalm 22 while he was on the cross? I have a suspicion that he was. Now, I can't prove it because the rest of it is not written in the gospel. So when you read through Psalm 22, you can see that obviously it's a messianic psalm. He's talking about this. There are different aspects where that's so vivid about what's going on the cross in there. So you take some time to read it and read through, being sensitive to that now. But there was something quite interesting at the end of Psalm 22, because at the end of Psalm 22, the scriptures or the Bible says that he ended it by saying that a generation shall arise. Let me actually read it properly so I don't misquote it, because I was going to paraphrase there just for time, but no, I think I would like to read this one a little bit. So just bear with me as I just read the very last two verses, verses 30 and 31. It says, a posterity shall serve him. It will be recounted of the Lord to the next generation. They will come and declare his righteousness to a people who will be born that he has done this. Now that phrase, he has done this, yeah, the Hebrew equivalent of that is the Greek equivalent of that is tetelestai, which basically is a completion, that God has completed this work. God has done it in itself. So I have my suspicions that Jesus Christ was quoting that psalm, but hey, again, this is a part of the nuggets that the Bible has that we need to chase down and truly appreciate and understand as we go along. Okay, so enough of salvation. Let's move on to the next one, which is what Jesus did in modeling the way we should live our lives God's way. Okay, two things we want to briefly touch on here, principles and guidelines. What did Jesus say? What were the principles that he laid down for us? And again, what are his instructions and commands? Now again, if you're very familiar with the Gospels, you will realize that there are quite a number of them, and we can't cover all of them now, but we'll do our best to try and give you a flavor of one or two bits of it. Principles, okay? The main thing I want to point out here is the importance of the heart. Jesus Christ spoke about the heart quite a lot. He did. And when you read through the Gospels, you would see that. He talked about having a pure heart, and he gave us a promise, that those who have a pure heart, they are the ones who will see God. So if we want to see God, we have to have pure hearts. He also did tell us that evil starts in the heart. Yeah. Again, the scriptures are there for your reference as well, so you can go back and have a look at them. But he does say evil starts in the hearts. He says that's where all the different murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, all those things come from the heart. So we do need to be sensitive when it comes to our heart. Now, I would have liked to spend some time going through and breaking down what the Bible really means by heart, but it does use it interchangeably between the soul and the spirit. And sometimes it can be a little bit difficult to discern which one. But if you carefully read through, yes, you can make those distinctions as you go ahead along there as well. But basically, if you take it about, if we look at it from the perspective of your soul, the emotions, the will, the mind, and the spirit, if you look at it as one whole package, then you probably won't go wrong with that. Okay. Now, Jesus Christ says that it's what comes from the heart that you will do. Yeah? And this is a very interesting one. I remember the scripture in Matthew 12:34 when he said this. He was speaking to the Pharisees then, and he said, "You brood of snakes," or "You brood of vipers, how could evil men like you speak what is good and right? For whatever is in your heart determines what you say." So it's quite interesting, if you listen to the speech of people, you can almost tell what is in their hearts. So again, we all have to be very careful the kind of things that we think in our hearts as well, because it will come out through our mouths. We will say it, you know, in one of those unguarded moments that will come out, and we all, well, maybe not all, but we are aware of how the Prime Minister gaffed a little bit, for want of a better way of explaining it. But yeah, what is in the heart always comes out through the mouth as well. So having a pure heart means that the only pure things will come out of the mouth. So it's one thing, so some things that we need to watch. And these are all principles that he has given us so that we can live right as well. Okay, again, he says the heart is the ground for God's word, and of course we know from the scripture of the sower, and the sower sows the word, and we'll look at that in a little bit. But the word, the heart is the ground, is the base, is the soil, for want of a better way of describing it, of God's word, where God's word grows. Okay. Also, it's the center of belief. This is the place where all the belief is. Now, you have to believe in the heart. We know that the scripture says if you believe in the heart, with the heart you believe, and the mouth you confess. So it's quite an important thing. But if you also remember in Proverbs, I think it's Proverbs 4:24, it says guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. So the heart is quite an important aspect there. Okay, again, according to the Lord Jesus Christ, love with the heart. It says love your Lord, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That's there. So love comes from the heart. And again, the heart can be troubled. We can be worried in our hearts in there. And quite in a number of places in the scripture, the Lord tells us, do not be troubled, do not be troubled, do not be troubled. Yeah. So it all goes there. So as you read through the Gospels, look out for what he says about the heart. Because I have a strong feeling, a strong belief, I think is the way I will put it, that if we get the heart right, everything else will flow right for us. So just thought I'll just point out those principles and guidelines from the heart. But I want us to have a look at this, the parable of the sower, just a little bit, because that's one parable where the Lord Jesus Christ graphically described different types of hearts in there. But I'm not going to go into that. We can read that in our own time. What I wanted to sort of do today with this one is just really point out something very quickly within the scripture. Now, I'm going to read the first part of it. I'm not going to read all of it. I'm just going to read the first part of it just for context. And once we've done that, then I'll explain a few things from there. Okay, so I'm going to read Matthew 13. I'm going to start from verse 3. Then he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, "Behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. Some fell on stony places where they did not have much earth, and they immediately sprang up because they had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no roots, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell on good ground and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, some 60, some 30. And then he says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Now, the Lord Jesus Christ likes to say that quite a bit, and we'll see why later on in there. But I have a question for you. What was in existence before the sower sowed? Just looking at that scripture, that which we've just read, not considering the rest of the world, but just saying, just from that, can we pick out a few things that were identified in what I've just read that were in existence before the sower actually sowed? Any takers? Any guesses? You can type it in the chat window and I'll see if it is, but again, you could just wait for me to just tell you whichever one you want. But I'd like you to actually just think about it for a moment, to see what can you spot in those in that scripture that there. Obviously, there is the sower, right? In this case, Jesus, you and I, we're all sowers. So there's a sower, there's a person, the person who goes to sow, okay? Obviously, there's the seed, which is the word of God in this case, as explained in the parable of the sower. And by the way, it's useful to read the accounts of the parable of the sower in the Gospels and read them again at one sitting. It's quite interesting because Matthew explains Mark, because Mark's version is a little shorter than Matthew's. So there are a few things in there, and I think I did mention it in one of the other webinars. But anyway, the seed, the word, is another thing that was there. Okay, the environment, or what I call the environment, the human heart, the ground, the soil, that was there. Those are obvious ones, yeah, okay. The sun is mentioned in there, in verse 6. So the sun was there before the sower sowed. This was there. Now the sun represents trials, pressures, issues of life, difficulties, those sorts of things, okay. Anything else? That would tell you that there are a few other things. Anything else? I better just draw your attention to it. I don't know if anybody picked this one up, because I was blown away when I realized it a couple of days ago. I think it was on Wednesday when this occurred to me. In verse 3, the scripture says, "Behold, a sower went out to sow." That to me is purpose. It was deliberate. He went out to sow. I'm going to sow. Now, why? I don't know. The scripture doesn't say so, but I am sure that there was a need or a desire or some results that this sower wanted. So maybe it was some nice, beautiful flowers, or whatever it was that he had in mind. The guy went out to sow. Or somebody went out to sow. Now, for you and I, this can be very useful information, because we all know that there are certain times when we have desires and needs, and I'll tie this all together in a minute or so. Okay, now what did the sower do? What did he do? Okay, obviously, very obvious, he sowed, and that's work. He worked, he did some work, because you cannot sow seeds without tilling the ground, putting it in the ground, burying it, watering it, and nurturing it so that it can grow and grow well. Yeah, the same thing happens with the Word of God. Yeah, if we have an issue, if we have a situation, if we are looking to do, we have a desire, there's something we want, we need to find the Word of God that relates to that, a promise of God, something that is already stated in there, in the scriptures, that God has already said, because he will do that which it is he is supposed to do. So the scripture says that we need to find the word, because the word is the seed that we're going to sow. We need to sow that in our heart. That's the work. That's really where the work is, because we're going to have to meditate on that. We're going to have to think about it. We're going to have to speak it. We're going to have to confess that word. We're going to have to build that word in our heart, so that that word will actually become life in us to be able to produce what it is that we desire. But we also have to believe it without any doubt. Yeah. Okay. Now, so this is what we have to do. Now, Luke says something very interesting in Luke 8:15. At the end of it, he says, "Cling to it and patiently produce a huge harvest." So that's where the work comes in, when we're waiting for an answer and it's not really coming as quickly as we need it to. Okay, so moving on quickly, we've looked at the principles there and guidelines, just some of them, and it's just sort of brought a practical example, taking the scripture, one of the scriptures that Jesus Christ referred to as a base foundation for understanding all parables. Okay, now let's have a look very briefly at instructions and commands. Okay, now it's easy to, this is a bit easy, because we had the great commandment. He basically, Jesus Christ told us, love God, love our neighbor. It's there, Mark 12:29-31. This is Jesus Christ's response to the teacher of the law, who asked him which is the greatest commandment, and he says, this is the most important commandment. Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God is the one and only Lord. And this is taken from the NLT. And you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. The second is equally important, love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than this. Now, I don't know if you caught something there, but this jumped out at me, this one, is when he said it, he said, the Lord our God, collective group, the Lord our God. But when he was referring to love, he says, you must love the Lord your God. He made it very personal. Yeah. So, loving God is a commandment, and it is personal. Each person has to develop that. It's not loving our God. Yes, he's our God, but he has to be personal to each and every one of us in there. Okay? Now, the Great Commission, again, most of us will be aware of this, and Jesus Christ, this is what he said to the disciples just before he left at the end of Matthew. He said, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth, therefore go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Okay, now how did Jesus model the great commandment? The woman caught in adultery is an example. Yeah, we know she was caught in adultery. The Pharisees brought only the woman, not the man who she was in adultery with, brought them to Jesus, and of course they wanted Jesus to condemn her, but he didn't. He basically didn't do that. So you can read that and see how he demonstrated his love to the woman by not condemning her, even though he could, because she was guilty of a sin. But that was not his purpose. He does not want any one of us to just perish like that. Again, another occasion was the widow of Nain, I think it is the way the scripture refers to her. Jesus was coming into the city, and they were bringing out this her only son. He had died, and he was going to be buried. And Jesus looked at the situation, and the scripture says he had compassion on her. And that's one word that you should look out for when you're reading through the Gospels. The number of times the scripture says he had compassion, he had compassion. And that will give you an indication, or as you read the scripture, what are the things that were that he sort of looked at the people were suffering from, and he just sort of said, okay, look, you know what, these people are suffering too much, we need to do something about it. And he does that. The same thing still happens to us today. Okay, how did he model the Great Commission? I'm moving a little quickly now because of time, and we still have a few more things to go through. How did Jesus model the Great Commission? Well, as a rabbi, he made many disciples. Now, this is an interesting thing, something I found out as I was looking through the records and the history, trying to understand how the Jews managed the relationships between rabbis and their disciples. Now, the ancient rabbis had mentoring relationships with disciples, and the disciples will watch their rabbis very closely. Now, actually, the word rabbi, as we call it, rabbi, is the actual pronunciation is rabbi, but rabbis, we all know them as rabbis, so let's go with that. And I'm not disciplined enough to change it, but I found out it was rabbi rather than rabbis, and I'm like, ooh, wow, okay, fine. But that's neither here nor there. Or if you prefer, rabboni, but that's a different case. But the key point here is that the disciples will watch the master or the rabbi very closely. And the key there is they want to understand and imbibe the customs, values, and character traits of their master. And that's what Jesus Christ is asking us to do, and we have to do so. Now, thanks be to God, he has the empty Jesus Christ in the whole of the Bible from beginning to the end, and we can pick out several different types of values, customs, character traits. For example, Jesus Christ had a custom of praying first thing in the morning. I'm not saying that's what you should do, but he had a custom of prayer. He did his first thing in the morning, but he spent time in prayer. And the scriptures say so quite a lot. He went into the synagogues on Sundays. Oh, sorry, not Sundays, on the Sabbath. He always was in the synagogue. He did not miss it for anything, whether it was in Capernaum or whether it was in Jerusalem. He was always in their synagogue somewhere as well. So there are different customs that he had, which we will do well to imbibe and to follow as well. Okay, so again, just some aspect of how Jesus Christ modeled living God's way to us in itself. Okay. Now, this is an interesting one. Destroy the works of Satan. Now, the scriptures, there's so many things he did, but I just wanted to very quickly pick on a few here. So just looking at some of the miracles of Jesus Christ. Now, he did many healing miracles, so many of them. And John even says that if we were to write all the healing ministries, he supposes that the books of the world would not be able to contain them. Okay, so there are quite a lot of them. So we can't even go through all of them. But I just thought we just needed just to point out a few things, that there were a number of physical miracles. Healing the leper, the lady with the withered hand, the one that was bent over, Peter's mother was sick, a number of them. So as you read the Gospels through, see if you can pick out the different physical healings that he did. One surprised me, and this is one that I didn't think, I'm not quite sure if many people picked it up, but there was one that I just considered, because I asked myself the question, did he heal anybody's mind in terms of, you know, were there any mental healings in there? And I was quite interested when I read the script in Mark chapter 5 from verses 1 to 20, and this is the demon-possessed man. Some people might, this is when he was in the country of the Gadarenes, but verse 15 is the one that caught my attention. I said, and it says, then they came to Jesus and saw the one who had been demon-possessed and had a legion sitting and clothed in his right mind. And that just made me think, oh, wow, okay, what is it that the scriptures doesn't have? Nothing. Everything is in there, including mental healings. Now, I'm not saying that every mental healing is demon-possessed. No, don't get me wrong. I'm just pointing out that Jesus heals physically and mentally. So whether it's an emotional thing or whether it's a mental mind thing, he does the healings. They're there. It's all there. Okay. Now, demons. He also cast out many demons. I don't even really think that we need to sort of go through that. But again, nowadays, when we hear the word demons, some of us, you know, rather afraid or we worried about them. But one thing you might want to know, to remember, is that throughout the scriptures, whenever the demons came across him, they bowed. they bowed, they submitted to him. So there is nothing to be afraid of them, and you'll see why in a minute. And of course, he set many people who were oppressed free. The scripture says about the woman who was in the synagogue, and he said, this woman has been bound by Satan for several years. So he does set people free. But this miracle, the miracle of the fig tree, was one that actually surprised me a lot, because it's a slightly different miracle or what it is, but it has quite a bit packed in it. So I'll just very quickly point this out, because I'm running out of time. And here, Jesus Christ, this background scenario, Jesus is going back into Jerusalem. He sees a fig tree. He wants to go and get some figs to eat because he was hungry. And he gets there. There's no fruit on the tree. And he curses the fig tree. And I'm thinking, why did you curse the fig tree? What did the fig tree do to you? It didn't have figs on it. Doesn't always have to have figs on it. But when you read it carefully, when you go and you have a look at things, fig trees produce fruits twice a year, early spring and late summer. And you can do a Google search and you will find this as a fact of life. In the Mediterranean, they produce it twice a year. In other climates, like in the UK, as I understand, you can actually grow fig trees here. I didn't know that, but as I was studying it, I realized that you could. Now, they grow twice a year, early spring and late summer. At the time when Jesus was going to the temple, this was around the time of Passover, which would have been early spring in those days in there. So you were expecting that by the time the leaves were green, as he saw them and there were flowers on there, that there will be figs already. The first figs would have been formed on that tree. But there was nothing there. But something really surprised me in there, when this, in that particular scripture. And that scripture, I think, is in Mark 11. Actually, let's look at the one in Matthew 28. No, that's not the right one. It's Mark 11. Let me just read that. Give me a second. And he says, Mark, yeah, 11. Okay. And in the New King James Version, it says that when the Lord, from verse, I'm going to read it from verse 14. It says, in response, meaning, and the King James says, and the Lord answered. Now, I'm wondering, what did the fig tree say to the Lord Jesus Christ? What did he say to him? Why the scripture says in response. So Jesus Christ was acting in response to something. Now, I am just suggesting that it was because that tree was being abnormal. It was not obeying the laws of nature that the Lord Jesus Christ had set himself, because it had no figs on it. So it's almost like saying, nah, 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 you can't have me. I mean, that's me anyway, but it was quite a thing. So I guess, you know, some people might think that's very controversial. Hey, I thought I'll throw that out there, chase it down, see if you agree with me. If you don't agree with me, it's okay. No, nothing there. Okay, but that leads to some of the boldest promises that Jesus Christ made. Because after that, he says this of us. He says, have faith in God. I tell you the truth. You can say to this mountain, may you be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and it will happen. He didn't say it may happen, I might think about it. He says it will happen. But you must really believe it will happen and have no doubt in your heart. I tell you, you can pray for anything, and if you believe that you've received, he didn't say you will receive, you've received, yeah, it will be yours. So that's a very bold promise. He's basically saying almost anything. This is like carte blanche if in terms of it. Okay. Another one he says in there is this. In John 14, he says, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done. Yeah, and even greater works than these he shall do, because I go to the Father. Right, so that's another bold promise there from the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, Now, another one here. He says, behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Yeah? Now, I just bring in all of that in place so that we can see that he has given us that which it is we need to continue in what he has said we should do. Right? Go. And as part of our remit, because the scripture says in, I think it's Ephesians chapter 3, he said that he established the church so that the church can declare to the principalities and powers the manifold wisdom of God. Yeah, that's what we are supposed to be doing. Okay, so this is a challenge to you, to me, because when I read these things, I say to the Lord, God, Lord, but you said that I will do the same works, and I desire so much to even do one-tenth of what he did, let alone all and more, because that's his promise to us as well. So let's take that on. Okay, very quickly, we know that the Lord Jesus is going to come back a second time. Yeah, it's very clear in the scriptures. I don't really want to sort of go through that, but I want us to just very quickly just take a look at this before we just stop for questions. Now, after John was thrown in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled, that the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And that's what Jesus Christ came preaching. Okay, now, we know that the kingdom we see is not yet the kingdom of the Lord. It's yet to be established. It shall surely come. It too shall come to pass. Okay, now, and there's a very clear picture of that happening, Revelation 21, if you read that, after the Great Tribulation. And Jesus Christ refers to the Great Tribulation in the books of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. You can see it all there. It's all written in there for us there. Okay. One thing he said about it, nobody knows when this is going to be. So that means that we all have to be on our guard because we have no idea when that's going to be. But he gave us some signs, and this is very key and very important to us. He says, when we see the abomination of desolation, hopefully for those of us, and I can't go into it right now, but those of us who hold on fast till the end, by the grace of the Almighty God, we shall not be here to see the abomination of desolation, but that's another thing. But he did also say that as the days of Noah, so shall it be in the time of the return of the Son of Man. We need to be careful. What does that really mean? That's something for us to go and have a look at. What were the days of Noah like? He said there will be increase in lawlessness. You just need to look around. I don't need to say much about that. Selfishness will increase. Even that, for me, is one thing that I keep seeing all the time and just bothers me so much. But hey, it's what it is. I can't do anything. And the one that baffles me the most and worries me the most of all is this bit here, that the church becomes lukewarm. Revelation chapter 3 from verses 14 to 12. The church of Laodicea. Read it. It is chilling. Jesus Christ is standing outside the church. Outside the church. That is really chilling. So let's be aware of those ones. Okay? But he holds us responsible to know. And if you read through the scriptures, he who has an ear, let him hear. Take heed. Whoever reads, let him understand. Yeah. Do not be deceived. He gives the responsibility is on us to know. So that means we've got to do our homework. We've got to check. We've got to read. We've got to study. We've got to pray. We've got to ask for illumination. And so that's why all of you that are on this webinar, I hope you've got something from it that will actually even give you something else that will make you just even seek him a little bit more. And let us all go forth and, you know, just bring forth that which it is that he's looking for us to do. I'm sorry I've overrun a little bit. It's just a little bit more than I wanted to, but I felt there were quite important things that we needed to sort of share with you. And so we'll just pause now for some questions. Okay, Wanu, over to you.
Thank you so much, Uncle. That was really insightful. My goodness, there was a lot there. I think we're going to have to go back, have a read, and just to digest it all. Are there any questions? I think I see some hands. Let's just try and work with technology here. Are there any questions? Right, 1 second.
Okay, there is a question here which says, if you don't mind, just let me read this. Thanks for the spotlight on the mental health scenario. How do you think we should engage with cases of mental health today? This is a very difficult one in the sense that not as with all situations to do with health and wellness, there are certain reasons or causes for those things, and we do need to try to understand what those causes are and what they may do. Now, I do believe that prayer will open up to our hearts. So first of all, we've got to care for and love them without any doubt, regardless of what the situation is. But we have to be understanding that there is something the matter. Now, by God's grace, he will give insight, because this is where things like the gifts of the Spirit, the word of knowledge or the word of wisdom comes into play, and also the gifts of healing, because by the compassion that you have towards a person who is being bothered by mental illness or mental health, then that is one potential trigger for the power of God to come in and help that person. So first things first, we must never run away from them or be afraid or concerned or worried for them, but compassion must flow, because that's one of the reasons why I mentioned the word compassion in the scriptures as we're reading through, because you would see in a number of places Jesus Christ had compassion, and that compassion, you know fully well, is what is the essence of God himself. He's loving, he's very compassionate, and so we have to do that. Now, it does need to be treated, so I would not say do not engage the traditional and the ways by which we do so in the world with doctors and stuff like that. No, we do need to do that. So they shouldn't be hidden away from everything. Let's go to the medical profession. That's why we have them. Let them diagnose. Let them do some. But pray, and also of course let's pray, because in prayer God reveals things to us. I hope that helps. Okay.
Thanks, Uncle. That's one of those. I think mental health is such a delicate issue. It's one of those I think we definitely need to talk a lot more about. So I'm glad that you actually touched on that tonight. I just pray that we'll all have the spirit of compassion to which you were referring to. Are there any other questions, Uncle? I think you did a really good job. I think everyone is reasonable. No,
there is one other question I've just spotted on there again. Yeah. Somebody's asked, do you think we are in the Laodicean age now? If so, what can we do to redress this? I want to say I don't think so, but I can see quite a bit of apathy, but I don't think it's as widespread as this as it is as the scripture would indicate from the Laodicean age. But in terms of a remedy, the scripture is very clear in terms of that one. The Lord Jesus Christ gives the remedy himself. He says, open the door. He says, behold, I knock. I stand at the door and knock. And it says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, we've got to open up to him. We've got to. I don't think we're fully there yet, but I think we're on our way. I see too many things around that maybe bother me personally, but I don't think we're there yet. We're not fully in the age, but if we're not careful, we'll get there. That's what I think about it anyway.
Okay, thanks, Uncle. There's another question here. He says, what is the significance of the green leaves on the fig tree and yet no fig fruit?
Okay. Now, the way the figs work in they blossom or they produce fruit twice a year, in the early spring and in the late summer, early autumn. Now, the early autumn is really the main part where these fruits are really sweet, but through the winter they begin to bud again. So you would begin to see the buds through the winter. And about early spring, they will now begin to form real figs. And by the time the figs are forming, also by the time leaves and flowers are showing on the fig tree, you should already have figs on it, because those figs would have developed through the winter. And they're not always as sweet as the ones that are produced in autumn, but they are nonetheless, they are there. So to go to the fig tree when it has the green leaves and is blossoming, is looking all good, but to not find any figs on there is apparently abnormal. That's the significance of it, which is why I think the Lord Jesus Christ actually cursed the fig tree and said, no one's going to eat of you because you're not obeying the natural laws. To me, it's just an indication of one of those things that Satan had warped around, and is an indication of how Jesus Christ treated such things, didn't give them time or to continue living. That's my take on it anyway.
Thank you so much.
I think we have time for just one more question. What do you think, Wenu?
Yeah, I think so. But then I just wanted to add, somebody mentioned also that regarding the mental health problems, I think he just wanted to encourage all of us. And he said, it's also about loving them as your neighbor and treat them as you would like to be treated. Just so yes. Sort of basic rules that we know, but we don't usually apply. One more question?
Yeah.
Okay.
We could. Okay, I've seen one here which I think is an interesting one. I don't know whether this is a one I can easily answer, but I'll give it a go. It says, how should we, the church, model the works of Jesus Christ as his ambassadors? $1 million question. I guess if we all knew, we would do it. No, I think it's a really simple thing. Yeah, we just need to be disciples. Because if you remember in the bit when we talked about them making disciples, one of the things that I sort of mentioned was that they would watch very closely the master, the rabbi. They will study the master. They will look at his values, his character traits, and then they will try to imitate a copy and do those things exactly as he did. And that's why I think the Lord Jesus Christ says, go and make disciples. He didn't say, go and preach the gospel. He said, go and make disciples, teaching them to obey. So there is a bit there that means that we have to live those values. So we've got to know them, we've got to understand them, and we've got to then live them in there. And that's also why I think the Lord Jesus Christ said that if we love one another, then they will know that we are his disciples. So it becomes very clear, because we are demonstrating the characteristics of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's why I said I think it is simple. But again, I know it's not as easy as, so easy to say, yes, just watch him and follow. I understand. Look, I'm a work in progress as well. I know my limitations. I know my weaknesses. I know. So I'm not really saying it as if flippantly or with anything, but it's the only thing that I have seen that I can use as a way of saying this is the way in which we can be ambassadors of him. We just have to do it the way he does it and the way he did it. And the scriptures show us in so many different ways. In all the scriptures, is modeled for us in so many different ways. So I think that's how we do it. Okay.
Thank
well,
you very
I think
much.
that's all we have time for.
Yeah, indeed. Thank you so much, Dikin Bumiolubade. That was very insightful. And you have come out right bang on an hour. Thank you so much. I know there was a lot to digest there, and you did really well trying to get all that into an hour. Unfortunately, we're not able to take any more questions, but please send in your questions still. We won't be able to answer them on the webinar today, but we can send you an email to answer the question later on after this webinar. So I'll just like to ask Dikin Bumi to close us out very quickly, and then we'll be good to go. Thank you so much.
Okay, let's just thank the Lord very quickly. Father, we really do thank you. Thank you for what we've been able to share. Thank you for what we have heard. Father, I do pray that you will breathe on the words that we have heard. Those things that are challenging us that we don't quite understand, Father, I pray that in the days to come that you will illuminate it for each and every one of us. I pray also, Father, that your promise that you say that he who has more shall be given to him. Father, please let more be given to each and every one of us. And in all things, Lord, you made us to be your image and your likeness. I pray thee, Father, that in the name of Jesus Christ, that we all will be true ambassadors, a reflection of you upon the earth, that all may know that you are God and there is none besides you. Thank you so much, Lord Jesus. Lord, as our shepherd, shepherd us in everything. Keep our homes, keep us well. Father, we commit ourselves into your hands with no reservation whatsoever, completely and absolutely casting ourselves onto you. Have your way in our lives. Let your glory be seen in our lives. Thank you, Heavenly Father. And Father, I pray if anyone whatsoever is in pain, sickness, or that requires healing, Father, from that which it is we have heard today, Lord, let it please you to manifest the healing that Jesus Christ gave and restored us to. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Have a good night, everyone, and see you next week. Good night.